The moderator, ladies and gentlemen, friends and enemies, tonight I hope that we can have a little fireside chat with as few sparks as possible being tossed around, especially because of the very explosive condition that the world is in today. Sometimes when a person is putting the house on fire and that person to whom the house belongs is asleep, if someone comes in yelling fire, instead of the person who's awakened by the yell are being thankful, they make the mistake of charging the one who awakened them with having set the fire. I hope that this little conversation tonight about the Black Revolution won't cause many of you to accuse us of igniting it when you find it at your doorstep. I'm still a Muslim. That is, my religion is still Islam. I still believe that there's no God but Allah, and that Muhammad is the apostle of Allah. That just happens to be my personal religion. But in the capacity that I'm functioning in today, I have no intention to mix my religion with the problems of 22 million black people in this country, just as it's possible for a great man whom I greatly respect, Ben Bella, to be a Muslim and still be a nationalist. And another one whom I greatly respect, Gamal Nasser, to be a Muslim and still be a nationalist. And Sukarno of Indonesia to be a Muslim and still be a nationalist. It was nationalism that enabled them to gain freedom for their people. I'm still a Muslim, but I'm also a nationalist, meaning that my political philosophy is black nationalism. My economic philosophy is black nationalism. My social philosophy is black nationalism. And when I say that this philosophy is black nationalism, to me this means the political philosophy of black nationalism is that which is designed to encourage our people, the black people, to gain complete control over the politics and politicians of our own community. Our economic philosophy is that we should gain control over the economy of our own community, the businesses, and other things that create employment so that we can provide jobs for our own people instead of having to picket and boycott and beg someone else for a job. And in short, our social philosophy only means that we feel it is time to get together among our own kind and eliminate the evils that are destroying the moral fiber of our society, like drug addiction, drunkenness, welfare problems. We believe that we should lift the level or the standard of our own society to a higher level wherein we will be satisfied and then not inclined toward pushing ourselves into other societies where we're not wanted. All of that aside, tonight we are dealing with the Black Revolution. During recent years, there's been much talk about a population explosion. And whenever they're speaking of the population explosion, in my opinion, they're referring to the people that's primarily in Asia or in Africa, the black, brown, red, and yellow people. It is seen by people of the West that as soon as the standard of living is raised in Africa and Asia, automatically the people begin to produce abundantly. And there has been a great deal of fear engendered by this in the minds of the people of the West, who happen to be on this earth a very small minority. In fact, in most of the thinking and planning of whites in the West today, it's easy to see that fear in their minds, conscious mind and subconscious mind, that the masses of dark people in the West, in the East rather, who already outnumber them, will continue to increase and multiply and grow until they eventually overrun the people of the West like a human sea, a human tide, a human flood. And this fear of death can be seen in the mind and in the actions of most of the people here in the West in practically everything that they do. It governs their political views, it governs their economic views, and it governs most of their attitudes toward the present society. I was listening to Dirksen, some senator from Illinois, in Washington, D.C. last week, filibustering the Civil Rights Bill. And one of the things he kept stressing over and over and over, that if this bill is passed, it'll change the social structure of America. Well, I know what he's getting at. And I think that most other people today, especially our people, know what is meant when these whites who filibuster these bills, especially and express fears of changes in the social structure, our people are beginning to realize what they mean. Just as we can see that all over the world, one of the main problems facing the West is race. Likewise, here in America today, most of your Negro leaders as well as the whites agree that 1964 itself appears to be one of the most explosive years yet in the history of America on the racial front, on the racial scene. Not only is this racial explosion probably to take place in America, but all of the ingredients for this racial explosion in America to blossom into a worldwide racial explosion present itself right here in front of us. America's racial powder keg, in short, can actually fuse or ignite a worldwide racial powder keg. And whites in this country who are still complacent when they see the possibility of a racial strife in this country getting out of hand, and you are complacent simply because you think you outnumber the racial minority in this country, what you have to bear in mind is wherein you might outnumber us in this country, you don't outnumber us all over the earth. And any kind of racial explosion that takes place in... any kind of racial explosion that takes place in this country today, in 1964, is not a racial explosion that can be confined to the shores of America. It's a racial explosion that can ignite the racial powder keg that exists all over the planet that we call Earth. Now, I think that anybody would agree that the dark masses of Africa and Asia and Latin America are already seething with bitterness, animosity, hostility, and unrest and impatience with the racial intolerance that they themselves have experienced at the hands of the white West. And just as they themselves have the ingredients of hostility toward the West in general, here we also have 22 million African Americans, black, brown, red, and yellow people in this country, who are also seething with bitterness and impatience and hostility and animosity over the racial intolerance not only of the white West in general, but of white America in particular. And by the hundreds of thousands today, we find that our own people have become impatient and are turning away from your white nationalism, which you call democracy, toward the militant, uncompromising philosophy of black nationalism. And I might point out right here that as soon as we announced that we were going to start a black nationalist party in this country, we received mail from coast to coast, especially from young people at the college level, the university level, who expressed complete sympathy and support and a desire to take an active part in any kind of political action based upon black nationalism designed to correct or eliminate immediately the evils that our people have suffered here for 400 years. The black nationalists, to many of you, may represent only a minority in the community. And therefore, you might have a tendency to classify it as something that's insignificant. But just as the fuse is the smallest part or the smallest piece in the powder keg, it is yet that little fuse that ignites the entire powder keg. The black nationalist, to you, may represent a small minority in the so-called Negro community, but yet they just happen to be composed of the type of ingredients necessary to fuse or ignite the entire black community. And this is one thing that whites, whether you call yourselves liberals, conservatives, or racists, or whatever you might choose to be, one thing that you have to realize is that where the black community is concerned, although the large majority that you come in contact with may impress you as being moderate and patient and loving and long-suffering and all that kind of stuff, the minority whom you consider to be Muslims or nationalists happen to be made of the type of ingredient that can easily spark the entire black community. This should be understood, because to me, a powder keg is nothing without a fuse. ...1964 will be America's hottest year. Her hottest year yet. A year of much racial violence and much racial bloodshed. But it won't be blood that's going to flow only on one side. The new generation of black people who have grown up in this country during recent years are already forming the opinion, and it's a just opinion, that if there's to be bleeding, it should be reciprocal. Bleeding on both sides. It should also be understood that the racial sparks that are ignited here in America today could easily turn into a flaming fire abroad, which only means it could engulf all the people of this earth into a giant race war. You can't confine it to one little neighborhood or one little community or one little country. What happens to a black man in America today happens to the black man in Africa. What happens to the black man in America and in Africa happens to the black man in Asia and to the man down in Latin America. What happens to one of us today happens to all of us. And when this is realized, I think that the whites who are intelligent, even though they aren't moral or aren't just or aren't impressed by legality, those who are intelligent will realize that when they touch this one, they're touching all of them, and this in itself will have a tendency to be a checking factor. The seriousness of this situation must be faced up to. I was in Cleveland last night, Cleveland, Ohio. In fact, I was there Friday, Saturday, and yesterday. And at the last Friday, the warning was given that this is a year of bloodshed, that the black man has ceased to turn the other cheek, that he has ceased to be nonviolent, that he has ceased to feel that he must be confined to all these restraints that are put upon him by white society in struggling for what white society says he was supposed to have had 100 years ago. So today, when the black man starts reaching out for what America says are his rights, the black man feels that he is within his rights. When he becomes the victim of brutality by those who are depriving him of his rights to do whatever is necessary to protect himself. And an example of this was taking place last night at this same time in Cleveland, where the police were putting water hoses on our people there and also throwing tear gas at them. And they met a hail of stones, a hail of rocks, a hail of bricks. Well, you're in a couple of weeks ago in Jacksonville, Florida, young teenage Negroes were throwing Molotov cocktails. Now, Negroes didn't do this 10 years ago. But what you should learn from this is they're waking up. It'll be Molotov, it was stones yesterday, Molotov cocktails today, it'll be hand grenades tomorrow, and whatever else is available the next day. The seriousness of this situation should be faced up to. You should not feel that I'm inciting someone to violence. I'm only warning of a powder keg situation that you can take it or leave it. If you take the warning, perhaps you can still save yourself. But if you ignore it or ridicule it, well, death is already at your doorstep. There are 22 million African Americans who are ready to fight for independence right here. When I say fight for independence right here, I don't mean any nonviolent fight. Oh, turn the other cheek, fight. Those days are gone. Those days are over. If George Washington didn't get independence for this country nonviolently, and if Patrick Henry didn't come up with a nonviolent statement, and you taught me to look upon them as patriots and heroes, then it's time for you to realize I have studied your books well. Our people, 22 million African Americans, are fed up with America's hypocritical democracy. And today we care nothing about the odds that are against us. Every time a black man gets ready to defend himself, some Uncle Tom starts trying to tell us, how can you win? That's Tom talking. Don't listen to him. This is the first thing we hear. The odds are against us. You're dealing with black people who don't care anything about odds. We care nothing about odds. Again, I go right back to the people who founded and who secured the independence of this country from the colonial powers of England. When George Washington and the others got ready to declare or come up with a Declaration of Independence, they didn't care anything about the odds of the British Empire. They were fed up with taxation without representation. And you've got 22 million black people in this country today, 1964, who are fed up with taxation without representation and will do the same thing. Who are ready, willing, and justified to do the same thing today to bring about independence for our people that your forefathers did to bring about independence for your people. And I say your people because I certainly couldn't include myself among those for whom independence was fought in 1776. How in the world can a Negro talk about the Declaration of Independence and he's still singing, "We Shall Overcome"? Our people increasingly are developing the opinion that we just have nothing to lose but the chains of segregation and the chains of second-class citizenship. So 1964, we'll see the Negro revolt evolve and merge into the worldwide black revolution that has been taking place on this earth since 1945. The so-called revolt will become a real black revolution. Now, the black revolution has been taking place in Africa and Asia and in Latin America. When I say black, I mean non-white. Black, brown, red, or yellow. Our brothers and sisters in Asia who were colonized by the Europeans, our brothers and sisters in Africa who were colonized by the Europeans, and in Latin America, the peasants who were colonized by the Europeans, have been involved in a struggle since 1945 to get the colonialists or the colonizing power, the Europeans, off their land, out of their country. This is a real revolution. Revolution is always based on land. Revolution is never based on begging somebody for an integrated cup of coffee. Revolutions are never fought by turning the other cheek. Revolutions are never based upon love your enemy and pray for those who despitefully use you. And revolutions are never waged singing, "We shall overcome." Revolutions are based on bloodshed. Revolutions are never compromising. Revolutions are never based upon negotiation. Revolutions are never based upon any kind of tokenism whatsoever. Revolutions are never even based upon that which is begging a corrupt society or a corrupt system to accept us into it. Revolutions overturn systems. And there's no system on this earth has proven itself more corrupt, more criminal than the system that right now, 1972... than this system that in 1964 still colonizes African Americans, still enslaves 22 million Afro-Americans. There is no system more corrupt than a system that represents itself as the example of freedom, the example of democracy, and can go all over this earth telling other people how to straighten out their house, and you have half of the citizens in this country who have to use bullets if they want to cast a ballot.
The greatest weapon that the colonial powers have used in the past against our people has always been divide and conquer. America is a colonial power. She has colonized 22 million Afro-Americans by depriving us of first-class citizenship, by depriving us of civil rights, actually by depriving us of human rights. She's not only deprived us of the right to be a citizen, she's deprived us of the right to be a human being, the right to be recognized and respected as men and women. And in this country, a black man can be 50 years old. He's still a boy. I grew up with white people. I was integrated before they invented the word. And I have never met white people yet, if you don't be around them long enough, who won't refer to you as a boy or a gal, no matter how old you are, no matter what school you came out of, no matter what your intellectual or professional level is. In this society, we remain boys. So America's strategy is the same strategy as that which was used by the past, by the colonial powers. Divide and conquer. She plays one Negro leader against the other. She plays one Negro organization against the other. She makes us think that we have different objectives, different goals. As soon as one Negro says something, she runs to this Negro and asks him, what do you think about what he said? Why, anybody can see through that today. Except some of the Negro leaders. All of our people have the same goal, the same objective: freedom, justice, equality. All of us want recognition and respect as human beings. We don't want to be integrationists, nor do we want to be separationists. We want to be human beings. Integration is only a method that's used by some groups to obtain freedom, justice, equality, and respect as human beings. Separation is only a method that's used by other groups to obtain freedom, justice, equality, or human dignity. So our people have made the mistake of confusing the methods with the objectives. As long as we agree on objectives, we should never fall out with each other just because we believe in different methods or tactics or strategy to reach a common objective. We have to keep in mind at all times that we aren't fighting for integration, nor are we fighting for separation. We're fighting for recognition as human beings. We're fighting for the right to live as free humans in this society. In fact, we're actually fighting for rights that are even greater than civil rights, and that is human rights. We are fighting for human rights in 1964. This is a shame. The civil rights struggle has failed to produce concrete results because it has kept us barking up the wrong tree. It has made us put the cart ahead of the horse. We must have human rights before we can secure civil rights. We must be respected as humans before we can be recognized as citizens. Among the so-called Negroes in this country, as a rule, the civil rights groups, or those who believe in civil rights, they spend most of their time trying to prove that they are American. Their thinking is usually domestic, confined to the boundaries of America, and they always look upon themselves as a minority. When they look upon themselves on the American stage is a white stage. So a black man standing on that stage in America automatically is in the minority. He's the underdog. And in his struggle, he always uses an approach that's a begging, hat-in-hand, compromise approach. Whereas the other segment or faction in America, known as the nationalists, black nationalists, are more interested in human rights than they are in civil rights. And they place more stress on human rights than they do in civil rights. The difference between the thinking and the scope of the Negroes who are involved in the human rights struggle and those in the civil rights struggle, those so-called Negroes involved in the human rights struggle don't look upon themselves as Americans. They look upon themselves as a part of dark mankind. They see the whole struggle not within the confines of the American stage, but they look upon the struggle on the world stage. And in the world context, they see that the dark man outnumbers the white man. On the world stage, the white man is just a microscopic minority. So in this country, you find two different types of Afro-Americans. the type who looks upon himself as the minority and you as the majority, because its scope is limited to the American scene. Then you have the type who looks upon himself as part of the majority and you as part of a microscopic minority. And this one uses a different approach in trying to struggle for his rights. He doesn't dare. He doesn't thank you for what you give him, because you're only giving him what he should have had 100 years ago. He doesn't think you're doing him any favors. He doesn't see any progress that he has made since the Civil War. He sees not one iota of progress, because, number one, if the Civil War had freed him, he wouldn't need civil rights legislation today. If the Emancipation Proclamation issued by that great shining liberal called Lincoln had freed him, he wouldn't be singing "We Should Overcome" today. If the amendments to the Constitution had solved his problem, still his problem wouldn't be here today. And even if the Supreme Court desegregation decision of 1954 was genuinely and sincerely designed to solve his problem, the problem wouldn't be with us today. So this kind of black man is thinking. He can see where every maneuver that America has made, supposedly to solve his problem, has been nothing but political trickery and treachery of the worst order. So today he doesn't have any confidence in these so-called liberals. Now, I know most of you all coming in here tonight, you don't call yourselves liberals. Because that's a nasty name today. It represents hypocrisy. So these two different types of black people exist in the Negro, so-called Negro community. And they are beginning to wake up, and their awakening is producing a very dangerous situation. So you have whites in the community who express sincerity when they say they want to help. Well, how can they help? How can a white person help the black man solve his problem? Number one, you can't solve it for him. You can help him solve it, but you can't solve it for him today. One of the best ways that you can solve it, or help him solve it, is to let the so-called Negro who's been involved in the civil rights struggle see that the civil rights struggle must be expanded beyond the level of civil rights to the level of human rights. Once it is expanded beyond the level of civil rights to the level of human rights, it opens the door for all of our brothers and sisters in Africa and Asia who have their independence to come to our rescue. Why? When you go to Washington, D.C., expecting those crooks down there to pass some kind of, and that's what they are. To pass some kind of civil rights legislation to correct a very criminal situation, what you're doing is encouraging the black man who is the victim to take his case into the court that's controlled by the criminal. It'll never be solved in that way. It's like running from the wolf to the fox. The civil rights struggle involves the black man taking his case to the white man's court. But when he fights it at the human rights level, it's a different situation. It opens the door for him to take Uncle Sam to world court. The black man shouldn't have to go to court to be free. Uncle Sam should be taken to court and made to tell why the black man is not free in a so-called free society. Uncle Sam should be taken into the United Nations and charged with violating the UN Charter on Human Rights. You can forget civil rights. How are you going to get civil rights with men like Eastman and men like Dirksen and men like Johnson? It has to be taken out of their hands and taken into the hands of those whose power and authority exceeds theirs. Well, and those in the civil rights struggle, those so-called Negroes involved in the human rights struggle, don't look upon themselves as Americans. They look upon themselves as a part of dark mankind. They see the whole struggle not within the confines of the American stage, but they look upon the struggle on the world stage. And in the world context, they see that the dark man outnumbers the white man. On the world stage, the white man is just a microscopic minority. Well, in this country, you find two different types of Afro-Americans. The type who looks upon himself as the minority and you as the majority, because his scope is limited to the American scene. Then you have the type who looks upon himself as part of the majority and you as part of a microscopic minority. And this one uses a different approach in trying to struggle for his rights. He doesn't beg. He doesn't thank you for what you give him, because you're only giving him what he should have had 100 years ago. He doesn't think you're doing him any favors. He doesn't see any progress that he has made. Since the Civil War. He sees not one iota of progress, because number one, if the Civil War had freed him, he wouldn't need civil rights legislation today. If the Emancipation Proclamation issued by that great shining liberal called Lincoln had freed him, he wouldn't be singing "We Should Overcome" today. If the amendments to the Constitution had solved his problem, still his problem wouldn't be here today. And even if the Supreme Court desegregation decision of 1954 was genuinely and sincerely designed to solve his problem, the problem wouldn't be with us today. So this kind of black man is thinking. He can see where every maneuver that America has made, supposedly to solve his problem, has been nothing but political trickery and treachery of the worst order. So today he doesn't have any confidence in these so-called liberals. Now, I know most of you all coming in here tonight, you don't call yourselves liberals. Because that's a nasty name today. It represents hypocrisy. So these two different types of black people exist in the Negro, so-called Negro community. And they are beginning to wake up, and their awakening is producing a very dangerous situation. So you have whites in the community who express sincerity when they say they want to help. Well, how can they help? How can a white person help the black man solve his problem? Number one, you can't solve it for him. You can help him solve it, but you can't solve it for him today. One of the best ways that you can solve it or help him solve it is to let the so-called Negro who's been involved in the civil rights struggle see that the civil rights struggle must be expanded beyond the level of civil rights to the level of human rights. Once it is expanded beyond the level of civil rights to the level of human rights, it opens the door for all of our brothers and sisters in Africa and Asia who have their independence to come to our rescue. Why? When you go to Washington, D.C., expecting those crooks down there to pass some kind of, and that's what they are. To pass some kind of civil rights legislation to correct a very criminal situation, what you're doing is encouraging the black man who is the victim to take his case into the court that's controlled by the criminal that made him the victim. It'll never be solved in that way. It's like running from the wolf to the fox. The civil rights struggle involves the black man taking his case to the white man's court. But when he fights it at the human rights level, it's a different situation. It opens the door for him to take Uncle Sam's the world court. The black man shouldn't have to go to court to be free. Uncle Sam should be taken to court and made to tell why the black man is not free in a so-called free society. Uncle Sam should be taken into the United Nations and charged with violating the UN Charter on Human Rights. You can forget civil rights. How are you going to get civil rights with men like Eastland and men like Dustin and men like Johnson? It has to be taken out of their hands and taken into the hands of those whose power and authority exceed theirs. Washington has become too corrupt. Uncle Sam's conscience. Uncle Sam has become bankrupt when it comes to a conscience. It's impossible for Uncle Sam to solve the problem of 22 million black people in this country. It is absolutely impossible to do it in Uncle Sam's court, whether it's the Supreme Court or any other kind of court that comes under Uncle Sam's jurisdiction. The only alternative that the black man in America has today is to take it out of Senator Dirksen and Senator Eastland and President Johnson's jurisdiction and take it downtown on the East River and place it before that body of men who represent international law and let them know that the human rights of black people are being invited and being violated in a country that professes to be the moral leader of the free world. Anytime you have a filibuster in America, in the Senate, in 1964, over the rights of 22 million black people, over the citizenship of 22 million black people, or that will affect the freedom and the justice and the equality of 22 million black people, it's time for that government itself to be taken before a world court. How can you condemn South Africa? There's only 11 million of our people in South Africa. There are 22 million of them here. And we are receiving an injustice that is just as criminal as that which is being done to the black people of South Africa. So today, those whites who profess to be liberals, and as far as I'm concerned, it's just lip profession. You understand why our people don't have civil rights? You're white. You can go and hang out with another white liberal and see how hypocritical they are. Why, a lot of you sitting right here know that you've seen whites up in a Negro's face with flowery words, and as soon as that Negro walks away, you listen to how your white friend talks. We have black people who can pass as white. We know how you talk. We can see that it is nothing but a governmental conspiracy to continue to deprive the black people in this country of their rights. And the only way we will get those rights restored is by taking it out of Uncle Sam's hands. Take him to court and charge him with genocide. The mass murder of millions of black people in this country, political murder, economic murder, social murder, mental murder. This is the crime that this government has committed. And if you yourself don't do something about it in time, then you're going to open the doors for something to be done about it from outside forces. I read in the paper yesterday where one of the chief justices, Goldberg, was crying about the violation of human rights of 3 million Jews in the Soviet Union. Imagine this. I haven't got anything against the Jews, but that's their problem. How in the world are you going to cry about problems on the other side of the world and you haven't got the problem straightened out here? How can the plight of 3 million Jews in Russia be qualified to be taken to the United Nations by a man who is a justice in this Supreme Court and is supposed to be a liberal, supposed to be a friend of black people, and hasn't opened up his mouth one time about taking the plight of black people down there to the United Nations? Our people are becoming more politically mature. Their eyes are coming open. They're beginning to see the trend in all of the American politics today. They notice that every time there's an election, it's so close among whites that they have to count the votes over again. This happened in Massachusetts when they were running for governor. It happened in Rhode Island. It happened in Minnesota and many other places. And it happened in the election between Kennedy and Nixon. Things are so close that any minority who has a black vote can swing it either way. And I think most of the students of political science agree that it was the 80% support that Kennedy got from the black man in this country that enabled him to sit in the White House. He sat down there 4 years and the Negro is still in the doghouse. Same ones that we put in the White House have continued to keep us in the doghouse. The Negro can see that he holds the balance of power in this country politically. It is he who puts in office, the one who gets in office. Yet when the Negro helps that person get in office, the Negro gets nothing in return. All he gets is a few appointments. A few hand-picked Uncle Tom handkerchief-head Negroes are given big jobs in Washington, D.C. And then those Negroes come back and try and make us think that that administration is going to lead us to the promised land of integration. And the only ones whose problem have been solved have been those hand-picked Negroes. A few big Negroes got jobs who didn't even need the job. They already were working. But the masses of black people are still unemployed. The present administration, the Democratic administration, has been down there for 4 years. Yet no meaningful legislation has been passed by them that's supposed to benefit black people in this country. Despite the fact that in the House they have 257 Democrats and only 177 are Republicans. They control two-thirds of the House. In the Senate, there are 67 Democrats and only 33 Republicans. The Democrats control two-thirds of the government. And it's the Negroes who put them in position to control the government. Yet they give the Negroes nothing in return but a few handouts in the form of appointments that are only used as window dressing to make it appear that the problem is being solved. No, something is wrong. And when these black people wake up and find out for real the trickery and the treachery that has been heaped upon us, you're going to have revolution. And when I say revolution, I don't mean that stuff they were talking about last year about we shall overcome. That's no revolution. The Democrats get Negro support, yet the Negroes get nothing in return. The Negroes put the Democrats first, yet the Democrats put the Negroes last. And the alibi that the Democrats use, they blame the Dixocrats. A Dixocrat is nothing but a Democrat in disguise. You show me a Dixocrat and I'll show you a Democrat. And chances are you show me a Democrat and I'll show you a Dixocrat. Because Dixie in reality means all that territory south of the Canadian border. There are 16 senatorial committees that run this government. Of the 16 senatorial committees that run the government, 10 of them are controlled by chairmen who are from the South. Of the 20 congressional committees that help run the government, 12 of them are controlled by Southern segregationists. Think of this. 10 of the senatorial committees are in the hands of the Dixocrats. 12 of the 20 congressional committees are in the hands of the Dixocrats. These committees can still control the government. And you're going to tell us that the South lost the Civil War. The South controls the government. And they control it because they have seniority. And they have seniority because in the states that they come from, they deny Negroes the right to vote. If Negroes could vote south of the... If Negroes could vote south of, yes, Canadian border, if south, if the Negroes could vote in the southern part of the South, Ellender wouldn't be the head of the Agricultural and Forestry Committee. Richard Russell wouldn't be the head of the Armed Forces Committee. Armed Services Committee. Robertson of Virginia wouldn't be the head of the Banking and Currency Committee. Imagine that, all the banking and currency of the government in the hands of a cracker. In fact, when you see how many of these committee men who control the government are from the South, you can see we got nothing but a cracker government in Washington, D.C. And their head is a cracker president. I said a cracker president. Texas is just as much a cracker state as Mississippi. And even more so. In Texas, they lynch you with a Texas accent. And in Mississippi, they lynch you with a Mississippi accent. And the first thing this man did when he came in office was invite all the big Negroes down for coffee. James Farmer was one of the first ones. The head of CORE. I have nothing against him. He's all right. Farmer, that is. But could that same president have invited James Farmer to Texas for coffee? And if James Farmer went to Texas, could he have taken his white wife with him to have coffee with the president? Anytime you have a man who can't straighten out Texas, how can he straighten out the country? No, you're barking up the wrong tree. If Negroes in the South could vote, the Dixiecrats would lose power. When the Dixiecrats lost power, the Democrats would lose power. A Dixiecrat loss is a Democrat loss. Therefore, the two of them have to conspire with each other to stay in power. The Northern Dixiecrats put all the blame on the Southern Dixiecrats. It's a con game, a giant political con game. The job of the Northern Democrat is to make the Negro think that he's our friend. He's always smiling and wagging his tail and telling us how much he can do for us if we vote for him. But at the same time, he's out in front telling us what he's going to do behind the door. He's in cahoots with the Southern Democrat, setting up the machinery to make sure that he'll never have to keep his promise. This is the conspiracy that our people have faced in this country for the past 100 years. And today you have a new generation of black people who have come on the scene, who have become disenchanted with the entire system, who have become disillusioned over the system, and who are ready now and willing to do something about it. So in my conclusion, in speaking about the black revolution, America today is at a time or in a day or at an hour when she's the first country on this earth who can actually have a bloodless revolution. In the past, revolutions have been bloody. Historically, you just don't have a peaceful revolution. Revolutions are bloody. Revolutions are violent. Revolutions cause bloodshed and death following their path. America is the only country in history in a position to bring about a revolution without violence and bloodshed. But America is not motivated to do so. Why is America in a position to bring about a bloodless revolution? Because the Negro in this country holds the balance of power. And if the Negro in this country were given what the Constitution says he's supposed to have, the added power of the Negro in this country would sweep all of the racists and the segregationists out of office. It would change the entire political structure of the country. It would wipe out the Southern segregationists who now control America's foreign policy as well as America's domestic policy. And the only way, without bloodshed, that this can be brought about is that the black man has to be given full use of the ballot in every one of the 50 states. But if the black man doesn't get the ballot, then you're going to be faced with another man who forgets the ballot and start using the bullet. Revolutions are fought to gain control of land, to remove the absentee landlord, and gain control of the land and the institutions that flow from that land. The black man has been in a very low condition because he has had no control whatsoever over any land. He has been a beggar economically, a beggar politically, a beggar socially, a beggar even when it comes to trying to get some education. So that in the past, the type of mentality that was developed in this colonial system among our people, that today is being overcome. And as these young ones come up, they know what they want. And as they listen to your beautiful preachments about democracy and all those other flowery words, they know what they're supposed to have. So you've got a people today who not only know what they want, but also know what they're supposed to have. And they themselves are creating another generation that is coming up that not only will know what it wants and know what it shall have, but will also be ready and willing to do whatever is necessary to see that what they should have materializes immediately. Thank you.